Hello learners, I am Harish Kumar Tyagi. Today we will talk about Right to Education Act 2009. On 26th of August 2009, the Indian Parliament passed a historic act regarding the education. It is known as Right to Education Act 2009. In view of the known achievement of goals of UEE, that is Universal Elementary Education, this was the most awaited step on the part of Government of India. But you will be surprised to know that Act to provide free and compulsory education to the children in the age group of 6 to 14 years was already framed and implemented by Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj in Kolhapur state, that is in Maharashtra, way back in 1902. In 1918, Vitthal Bhai Patel made primary education compulsory in all municipal councils of Bombay state by passing an act to that effect. Mahatma Gandhi's basic system of education of Wardha scheme of education 1937 also advocated for compulsory and free education for children. You will definitely appreciate the argument of Mahatma Gandhi that every person has right over free air and water. Similarly, free education should be available to each and every child, and it is the duty of society, of government, to look after the welfare of the child. Rules of the RTE Acts are for actual implementation of RTE Act. Some rules are framed which are called the Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Rules 2009. These rules may vary up to some extent for state to state. Here, every state may frame its own rules. That's why they can easily vary. Here, we shall try to study some of the important rules for free and compulsory education of child. Number one, we can say provisions and methods, special training of children in order to bring them up to the learning level of their peers, the limits of neighborhood schools, and duties of the state government and local authorities in upgradation of schools, provisions of transport facilities or residential facilities, and all forms of learning support to children with disabilities to ensure completion of elementary education, methods and details of records to be maintained of children within the jurisdiction of the local authority, responsibility of schools and teachers with regard to enrollments and classroom transactions with children from weaker sections and disadvantaged groups, documents and age proof required for every child, application and procedure to be followed by all schools other than a school established owned or controlled by the state government or by the local authority in order to gain the recognition as maintained by the Act. Conditions and procedures under which this recognition could be withdrawn, composition and functions of the school management committee, details on the school development plan to be designed and monitored by the SMC, teacher qualifications norms, like preliminaries we have in preliminary section, which is dedicated to the defined keywords of the rules to RTE. Act means the Right to Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act 2009. B, Anganwadi means an Anganwadi center established under the Integrated Child Development Scheme of the Ministry of Women and Child Development of the Government of India. C, appointed date means the date on which the act comes into force as notified in the official gazettes. D, chapters, section and schedule means respectively chapter, section of and schedule to the act. E, child means any child of the age group of 6 to 14 years. F, pupil cumulative records means record of the progress of the child based on his or her comprehensive and continuous evaluation. G, school mapping means planning school location to overcome social barriers and geographical distance. The right of children to free and compulsory education. Here we are going to discuss what are the various rights of the child when he is going to get a compulsory or free education. So, number one is like special training. Under this section, special training for those students whose admission is delayed is to be given by the specially appointed teachers. The purpose of this training is to enable students to successfully integrate themselves with the rest of the class academically and emotionally as well. Duration of the training shall be of 3 months. As a teacher, it is our duty to help the children who are lagging behind. So, we have to enroll each and every child, no doubt he is coming from any creed or caste. Special training for the purpose of first provision of section 4. This section says that the school management committee, local authority shall identify children requiring special training and organize such training in the following manner. Here we can explain these manner in such a way like the special training shall be based on specially designed age appropriate learning material approved by the academic authority specified in section 29A. It shall be provided in classes held on the premises of the school or through classes organized in safe residential facilities. It shall be provided by teachers working in the school or by teachers specially appointed for this purpose. So, the duration shall be for a minimum period of 3 months, which may be extended based on periodical assessment of learning progress of a child for a maximum period not exceeding 2 years. The child shall, upon induction into the age appropriate class after special training, continue to receive special attention by the teacher to enable him or her for successful accession. And it will integrate with the rest of the class academically and emotionally. Duties of the state government are, so here we are going to discuss first the duty of local authority. This local authority will establish by the government of state, and also it will open the school within a radius of 1 kilometer so that it can be easily accessed to the child's and going to learn his materials etcetera and receiving his education up to class 1 to 5 within a walking distance of 3 kilometers for the students of class 6 to 8. So, here we can say those children who are coming in the category of 1 to class 5, they may go to the distance within the 1 kilometer from their residence, and the children who are studying in class 6 to 8, they can go within a walking distance of 3 kilometers. So, these things have been mentioned under this state government's duties. In a particular area of the schools already exist, then classes are per requirement shall be added to those schools. You know that many states in our country could not evolve the network of elementary school. As per requirements, transportation or residential facilities are to be provided by the concerned state government as per the need of the children. We should appreciate the efforts put in by some state governments in this regard. Some states are issuing free travel passes to girls students, while some are providing bicycles to the girls for enabling them to attend the school. So, it is an appreciable step by these state governments. For establishing neighborhood schools, the state government local authority is going to undertake the school mapping and all types of children, including children with special needs, shall be identified by the authorities. Maintenance of the record. Now, the question arises, who is going to maintain the records of all these things? So, here the local authority shall maintain a record of all children in its jurisdiction through a household survey from their birth till they attain the age of 14 years, and the record shall be updated each year. So, we can say here that local authority is responsible to look into the matter that each and every child is enrolled who is not going to the school, and it is their duty to bring back them or to enroll them in their schools. Here, as a teacher, our role is of vital importance. It is our duty to bring to the notice of the local authority any deviation from the rights of the child, in particular physical and mental harassment of the children, denial of admission, etc. We should be very watchful regarding this issue. We are required to identify the needs of the children and to prepare a plan and mother the implementation of the provisions of RT Act 2009. The local authority is expected to monitor the implementation of the midday meal in the school also. As you know, this scheme is already in the existence from 1986. It was mentioned in 1986 National Policy on Education that we have to enroll each and every child by providing them certain incentives. So, midday meal is one of them. And in this regard, many states are doing a lot of efforts and they are making this scheme as a practicable. It is our duty to check the malpractices, if any, at our level occurs. So, the management committee shall prepare a school development plan, which shall be for 3 years. It shall include infrastructural requirements, requirements regarding human resources like appointment of headmasters, appointment of teachers, appointment of staff, and appointment of additional financial requirements, and also as per the need of the school. We can assist the management committee for preparing this plan. So, here the responsibility of school and the teachers are that every school controlled or recognized by the state government shall help to implement this provision of Right to Education Act 2009. We should never forget that the school is not run for profit to any individual, group or association of individuals or any other person. The role of district education officer is very often very important, and because he is expected to act as custodian to implement the provisions of RT Act in any effective way. So, here this school education officer will work as a custodian. The school shall work under the instructions of DEO, that is district education officer. As a teacher, will have to play a vital role in the universalization of elementary education, because we are supposed to be main human resource in the implementation of Right to Education Act. Our school may face the action of derecognition if we fail to comply with the responsibilities entrusted with ourselves and the school. We are required to identify and enlist all eligible children within our areas of work, identify the neighborhood school and make the same available to the child. Means if some schools are available in our nearby or in our locality, so we can ask these schools to enroll such children, those who are away from the school. School management committee's role, as you know, that management is an important aspect of education. We need to manage our school in a better way if we wish to give elementary education to all the children. As per provision of RT Act, the school management committee shall be constituted mainly out of parents of children, and their strength shall be 75%. Some of the important functions of the committee may be as follows, like monitor that the children, the teachers are not burdened with the academic, non-academic duties expect with those of census and elections. So, first time in this RT Act, it has been mentioned, and it has been realized that teachers were very much busy during the elections, and they were being engaged in doing the census activities. So, first times they have made free, and this has been ensured that they should not be given such duties. And in addition to the normal duties, the teachers are required to maintain a file containing the cumulative record of every child, which will be like on the basis of their previous record, we can project that how the child is and how the child's behavior was and how his activities were in the class rooms, etc. We are expected to participate in training programs, curriculum formulations, training modules, and textbooks development. There shall be a grievance redressal mechanism for teachers. You see, today, even the teachers are victimized. So, there should be a grievance redressal shell. So, first time it has been realized in RT Act that it should be constituted. The state government shall constitute school tribunals at the state level, district level, and block levels. The state or local authority shall maintain the pupil teacher ratio, means what is the ratio of the pupil as well as the teachers. So, it should be not more than 30 students for one teacher. And teachers, the academic authority of the concerned state lays down the qualification of the teachers. So, here whatever the qualification of the teachers have been laid down, it should be there, and the teachers should be recruited as per the fulfillment of their qualification. The minimum qualification laid down by this authority are applicable to all schools. In a state where there is a shortage of trained teachers, or there is a qualification may be relaxed for the appointment, but the teacher should be at least possesses the minimum academic qualification as may be prescribed by the government. So, here the curriculum and completion of the elementary education. So, here in this RT Act, it has mentioned what type of curriculum and when it is going to be completed has been discussed. The state government shall notify the state council of educational research and training or its equivalent as the academic authority. Means this SCERT will definitely be authority to maintain and to supervise the schools coming under its jurisdiction, while it shall formulate syllabus and textbooks and other learning materials. It shall also help in-service teachers training program, design and prepare guidelines for implementing curriculum and practicing continuous comprehensive evaluation. The certificate of completion of elementary education shall be issued at the school, block and district level. So, here it is fairly to mention that RT Act has also given due emphasis for the training of the teachers also. It has also mentioned that as a teacher, you have to be careful in maintaining all types of records, especially cumulative records of every child, which will help you assess the overall development of the child. So, here again it will be fair to say that cumulative record has the record of a child of beginning to till date. It means what was the position of a child academically, socially, emotionally or psychology when he has taken the admission, and what is the position of the child right now. So, on the basis of this cumulative record, things can be predicted about the child and protection of the right of the children. Many states in the country have constituted state commissions for protection of the child rights. In respect of a state which does not have a state commission or protection of the child rights, the state government may take immediate step to set up such commissions. Till such time, an interim authority known as Right to Education Protection Authority, that is REPA, shall be set up. It has been found that in spite of establishment of commissions or authorities, the objectives are not achieved completely due to absence of cooperation and commitment at all the levels. So, as a teacher, it is our prime duty to work sincerely and cooperate for achieving the cherished goal of RT Act 2009. So, what types of rights are? Like children's rights are defined in numerous ways, including a wide spectrum of civil, cultural, economic, social and political rights. Rights tend to be of two general types, like those advocating for children as autonomous persons under the law and those placing a claim on society for protection from harms prepared on children because of their dependency. These have been labeled as the rights of empowerment, as the rights of the protection. One Canadian organization categorizes children's rights into three broad categories. Number one is provision. Children have the right to an adequate standard of living, health care, education and services, and to play and recreation. These include a balanced diet, means here they have given emphasis on the balanced diet also, a warm bed to sleep in, and access to schooling. They have also mentioned the protection under the rights. Children have the right to protection from abuse, neglect, exploitation, and discrimination, means they say that no child should be discriminated and no child should be neglected, and they should be free from all the abuses and sins, etc. So, this includes the right to safe place for children to play, constructive child's rearing behavior, and acknowledgement of the evolving capacities of the children. Participation under these rights, Canadian says that children have the right to participate in communities and have programs and services for themselves. This includes children's involvement in libraries and community programs, youth voice activities, and involving children as decision makers. In a similar fashion, the Child Rights Information Network, or CRIN for short, categorizes rights into two groups. So, these are some categories of the child's right. Number one, economic, social and cultural rights related to the conditions necessary to meet basic human needs such as food, shelter, education, health care and gainful employment. Included are rights to education, adequate housing, food, water, standard of health, right to work and right at work, as well as the cultural right of minorities and the indigenous people. Number two, environmental, cultural and developmental rights, which are like called as the third generation rights, and including the right to live in safe and healthy environments, and that groups of people have the rights to cultural, political and social development. Scholarly study generally focuses children's rights by identifying individual rights. The following rights allow children to grow up healthy and free, like number one, freedom of speech, freedom of thought, freedom from fear, freedom of choice, and right to make decisions, ownership over one's body. So, these are the rights of a child, and education is the concurrent list. Education has been included in the concurrent list. As you know, to impart education is the joint responsibility of center as well as of the state governments. The central government and the state government shall have concurrent responsibility for providing funds for carrying out the provisions of RTE Act. So, here certain amounts on education is spent by the center and certain amount is spent by the state. Sometimes this amount is borne by the 50-50% by both the government. The central government shall prepare the estimate of capital and recurring expenditure for the implementation of the provisions of RTE Act. The central government shall provide to the state government as grants in aid of revenues such percentage of expenditure as it may determine from time to time in consultation with the state government. The state government, from the funds received from the central government and its own resources, will be responsible to provide funds for the implementation of the provisions of RTE. It shall be the joint responsibility of the central government and the concerned state government to provide free and compulsory education to every children till they attain the age of 14 years. Here we should not forget that it is not necessary to meet this huge expenditure by a single government. So, provisions have to be made to provide quite an adequate funds. It is going to be biggest challenge to spare thousands of crores of rupees for this task. the concerned state government will have to ensure the compulsory admission, attendance and completion of elementary education by every child in the age group specified above. We have here mentioned that age group is 6 to 14 years. So, it is the duty of the government to provide free and compulsory education to all the children till they attain the age of 16 years. So, we have to ensure that availability of the neighborhood school means school should be available in nearby locality, and it has to be ensured that no discrimination is made on any ground among children regarding persuasion of elementary education. Here also we are expected to work for checking discrimination. If discrimination is found somewhere in any school, etc., then we have to be very careful and we have to stop it. Ensure the availability of all types of infrastructural and educational facilities to each and every child for completion of elementary education. Many a time, in want of financial support, we could not provide good infrastructural facilities. Here again, it is our duty to avail finances from various resources. Ensure that quality elementary education is accessible to every and each child. Our role as a teacher is important in maintaining the quality of elementary education and provide training facilities to the teacher working in the area of elementary education. It is in fact a good opportunity for us to acquire the necessary qualifications or necessary training which may further help us for teaching in a better way. It may also give stability in a teacher's career. So, in this way we are going to achieve this RTE Act. So, let us sum up whatever we have learned today. Here we have discussed the concept and need of universalization of elementary education, which means making available elementary education to each and every child. It has been clearly mentioned in Article 45 that Constitution will try to provide free and compulsory education to all the children till they attain the age of 14 years. Constitutional provisions are also reviewed. In the year 2002, the Parliament of India made 86 constitutional amendments in Article 21A. It was inserted which makes the right of education a fundamental right of the children. In the age group of 6 to 14 years, you have also studied reasons for non-achievement of goals of UEE. In 1959, the United Nations declared the rights of the child, right of survival, right to name and nationality, right to nutrition, right to expression, right to health and care, right to protection from neglect and exploitation, right to education, right to information, right to protection from abuse and right to recreation are some of the important rights of the child. So, dear learners, we have learned today about the Right to Education Act 2009 and also about the universalization of elementary education. Thank you, learners. We will meet in next lecture. Till then, bye and have a good day.